Graphic Audio, a movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents the Nuclear Bombshell series by John Zakour and Lawrence Ganem. Narrated by Richard Rowan. With performances by Kimberly Gilbert, David Coyne, Colleen Delany, Denny Gavigan, Nanette Savard, Ken Jackson, Casie Platt, Bradley Smith, Evan Casey, Eric Messner, Nick DePinto, Elizabeth Jernigan, Gregory Gorton, Michael Glenn, Joe Brack, Terence Aselford, Nathanial Perry, and Mort Shelby. The Radioactive Redhead.
In the early 1700s, after spending close to 50 years studying ancient biblical texts, the father of modern physics, Sir Isaac Newton, predicted that the world would end in the year 2060. He never mentioned anything about a redhead. If he had, I might have been a little more careful. Some men are born dangerous, some men become dangerous. Some men have danger thrust upon them. And whenever danger decides to do a little thrusting, I always seem to be on the blunt receiving end of it.
The good news is that the shite in this production appears to be particularly skilled. The bad news, of course, is that he's also an android assassin.
He's a what? The kabuki actor's prop sword suddenly flared a fiery red, and he leapt at me from the raised stage overhead. Yeah! His red and white makeup glared under the hot lights, and a manic look of bloodlust danced across his cold, slightly crossed eyes.
Oh, what a pity. This promised to be a fine production of Shishingara.
Try to focus on the big picture here, Harv. I grabbed the actor's sword arm as he swung the energy plate at my head. Sure enough, his wrist was hard and unyielding, definitely the tempered polymer shell of a droid. And definitely more trouble than I was expecting. I slid sideways, putting the droid's own momentum into a judo throw as I pivoted. The heat of the blade singed my face as it flashed past, and the droid tumbled over me, falling flat into a large table of six nearby. His blade burned through the table like a fat man through a cream pie when he landed, and the whole thing gave way beneath him. My name is Zachary Nixon Johnson. I am the last private eye on Earth, and right now, I'm seriously regretting my choice of career. It is the year 2060, and let me say at the outset that this is not the way I usually spend my weekend nights. You may not believe it, but I'm a bit of a home buddy at heart. Dinner theater is not my scene. Kabuki dinner theater, despite being all the rage at the Nano, is really not my scene. And kabuki dinner theater in a trendy, free-floating restaurant 300 meters above downtown Oakland? Well, you see where I'm going with this, right?
It's an interesting strategy.
I quickly climbed to my feet.
It's illegal, as you know, to create an android with realistic skin tones. Creating a droid with a skin tone that emulates traditional kabuki makeup, however, is completely legal. Granted, the places to use such an assassin without drawing undue attention are somewhat limited.
Yeah, leave it to us to find the loophole. I had come to the Oakland Kabuki Palace Theater and Dinette to meet a client, a potential client, actually. I don't usually do blind dates when it comes to business, but things had been a little slow of late, so when the cold call came in last night asking for a no-strings-attached meet-and-greet, I figured that it wouldn't hurt to hear the offer. I was wrong, especially about the wouldn't hurt part. The droid popped back onto his feet and brandished his energy sword with a dramatic twirl that utterly delighted the dinner theater patrons around us, even as they ducked for cover. They were still under the impression that this was part of the show, and they were ready for more in-your-face kabuki dinner theater action. I, on the other hand, was not in the mood for audience participation. I flicked my wrist and cupped my hand in just the right way to activate the tiny motion sensor of the hidden holster that I wear on my forearm. The holster responded by smoothly popping my gun into my hand. The droid leapt high in the air toward me, sword flashing in a fiery wide arc. Big bang, tight! I pulled the trigger even as I dove to the floor. My energy blast hit the droid squarely in the chest, punching a hole through its innards and shorting out its central power unit. The crowd rose from beneath their tables.
A Kabuki assassin droid. I think that's a first.
Indeed, but don't cherish the uniqueness of the experience too long.
Why not?
Because in a nano, it won't be so unique.
What?
I turned just in time to see two more Kabuki actors charge me from two of the narrow runways. Each held a samurai sword that flamed to life as he ran.
You gotta be kidding me.
Oh, come now. You didn't really think there was going to be only one Kabuki assassin droid, did you? Especially considering the production they're doing?
The restaurant was a huge high-ceilinged circular room with doorways at each of the four compass points and a raised stage at the center for Theater in the Round productions. At the north point was the main entrance, whose great doors opened to the red carpet hoverport, and two dozen tiny valet bots programmed for parking and bringing round the patrons' hovercrafts. At the east end was the emergency exit, a rapid-fire teleportation gate with a preset destination of the street below. West was the restrooms, which I'm told were very swanky. And south was the kitchen. A catwalk ran the full circumference of the dining room, and four smaller catwalks stretched outward from the stage. Three went directly into the audience. One went to a set of large double doors on the western wall near the restrooms, no doubt leading to the dressing rooms for the actors, including the two droids currently intent on turning me into Dice Detective Sashimi. I hopped onto a table and pulled myself up to the catwalk to meet the charging samurai actors.
What the toss is going on here?
Harv's hologram shimmered to life beside me.
Well, let me think.
Harv adjusted the cuffs of his holographically starched shirt.
An anonymous potential client calls, refuses to give his name or the details of what he needs, and arranges to meet us at a Kabuki dinner theater presentation, where, by coincidence, we are attacked by Kabuki assassins immediately upon our arrival.
I get it, Harv.
Did I or did I not say that blind meetings and anonymous clients are a bad combination?
Yeah, well, if it was up to you, we'd never leave the office.
I should inform you, Zach. Right now, the office is looking pretty darn good.
You can gloat later, provided we survive. Right now, we have to get the bystanders to safety. I'll keep the samurai occupied. You handle crowd control.
I'm on it.
Harv lifted his holographic form onto center stage and turned his visage to the crowd.
Ladies and gentlemen, please do not panic. We are experiencing some intensely dangerous technical difficulties. We would be most grateful if you would all immediately proceed to the emergency exits in a quick and orderly fashion while Mr. Zachary Nixon Johnson battles the deadly dinner theater Kabuki android assassins.
None of the patrons made the slightest move toward the exits. I, meanwhile, was up on the catwalk facing down two charging samurai.
I suppose discussing this like reasonable beings is out of the question.
In response, both samurai pulled a handful of shurikens from the folds of their robes and hurled them at me as they charged. I spun and dove to the floor of the catwalk, but not before taking three or four hits to the shoulder and back. Luckily, the body armor I wear under my clothes absorbed the impact and stopped the razor-sharp spikes before they pierced my skin.
Yep, should have seen that coming.
I rolled over onto my stomach and fired at the nearest samurai. He fell to the floor in a spray of sparks. I rolled and smoothly popped into a crouch position, gun steady in hand, and leveled directly at the remaining samurai as he charged. I had to admit, I was starting to feel in the groove. And that, of course, was when I got hit over the head by a samisen and kneecapped hard by another. The first rule of Kabuki theater, never turn your back on the musicians, which, come to think of it, is probably the first rule of any kind of theater.
I really mean it here, people. This is not a drill. The Kabuki actors and entertainers you see around you are, in actuality, soulless androids designed expressly for merciless killing. You do not want to be eating dinner around these entertainers. Now please, evacuate this building immediately.
I ducked under the swing of the samisen player's next swipe, took him down to the ground with a leg sweep, then, with a point-blank blast to the face, blew his head off. The crowd was really excited about that, partly from the smoothness of my fighting moves, but mostly I think because the samisen music had gotten on their nerves as well.
This is the last time I go to a Kabuki play.
Oh, watch your back.
I turned and managed to dodge the swing of a psi-wielding actress droid as she attacked. I stumbled backward as she came at me again, with both psi at once. I popped my gun back into its holster and caught both droid hands at the wrists and tried very hard to keep the razor-sharp blades from my chest. The droid brought itself closer to me and pushed back with considerable strength. and I notice the subtle yet distinctive male features of its face.
Wait, I thought this was a woman.
It's a droid.
I know, but I thought it was a droid posing as a woman.
It's an arrogant.
A what?
Women aren't allowed to participate in traditional kabuki theater, so all female parts are played by men posing as women. They're called ergato.
Oh, like English theater during the Elizabethan period.
Very good.
Hey, this isn't the first time I fought thespians, you know.
The droid suddenly pushed me back. I rolled backward onto the floor, planted my foot on the droid's chest as I did so, and tossed her over me. She flew off the catwalk like a silk kerchief on a spring breeze, her floral pastel kimono arcing through the air. It was absolutely lovely, save for the fact that she was headed straight toward the table of a party of four, a double date, I think. All of whom were now running for their lives. She landed awkwardly on the table, hands beneath her, and impaled herself on her own blades.
Who knew Kabuki Theater was so accessible?
Harv, why is the audience still here?
Because they're morons. They think this is all part of the show, and I can't convince them otherwise.
Well, if they don't understand the truth, tell them a lie!
What kind of lie?
Use your imagination!
I'm not programmed for imagine...
Harv's holographically created eyes flashed with a spark of inspiration. It was eerily human.
Never mind. I'll handle it. By the way, watch out for the Ichi and Kaniro.
The what?
Just as Harv's hologram disappeared, two more Obi-clad droids with swords leapt at me from the catwalk. I ducked under the sword swipe of one and blasted the other in the chest while Harv made a return to center stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Oakland Kabuki Palace Theater and Dinette thanks you for coming to tonight's special presentation featuring the dinner theater debut of Zachary Nixon Johnson.
This isn't helping, Harv.
Tonight's performance was sponsored by your good friends at World Tax Association, funding the boondoggies of today with your savings of the future. And as a special treat for you all, the WTC will be giving free tax audits to those of you still in attendance after the show. Your own personal auditors will be arriving at your tables in just a few nanos with free bottles of new and improved Zima.
The crowd headed for the exits faster than Fat Farm escapees to the buffet line. When the line at the hoverport got too long, Harv holographically disguised himself as a tax auditor and sent the majority of them sprinting toward the emergency exit ramp.
Nice work, Harv.
I slammed a droid's head into a tray of tajiki.
I thought it was rather inspired.
Another droid came at me with a flaming sword arcing high overhead.
Any idea who sent these droids after me?
I spun away from the attacker's swing and let his sword slice into the prostrate droid on the table beside me. The laser blade sliced through the down droid's head and deep into the tajiki beneath, flash-frying the swordfish bellies.
Clearly someone who doesn't like you, although that hardly narrows down the list of suspects.
Thanks.
Someone brilliantly fiendish, that's for certain. Someone with a flair for the dramatic, yet with no regard whatsoever for human life.
Anarchistic terrorist?
I was thinking of a Broadway producer in need of a hit, but your guess is possible too.
I popped my gun back into hand and blew the droid's kabuki e-brains across the buffet table.
Tweet me! How many of these droids are there?
Well, this evening's presentation was to be of the drama Shingara.
Meaning what?
Nothing in and of itself, but I think you'll be interested in the play's subtitle.
Subtitle?
Revenge of the 47th Samurai.
The doors at the end of the catwalk exploded outward, and a horde of droids charged through in a veritable kimono-clad cavalcade of kabuki choreographed death.
47, huh?
They seem to be doing a very faithful adaptation.
Yeah, lucky us. I think it's time to leave.
Actually, the optimal time to leave would have been about 10 minutes ago.
The flow of the fight had brought us to the center of the room with a kabuki horde charging us from the western end of the catwalk. Some of the droids leapt off the catwalk and were now scrambling toward us on the floor as well. Even so, escape would be easy. A simple matter of running to the hoverport at the north end or to the emergency porter at the east end. There was nothing but open space between us and freedom.
Help! Someone help me!
Yeah, as if my life would ever be that easy. The woman's scream came from the southwestern end of the room, and it wasn't hard to spot her when I turned. By not wearing kabuki makeup, she sort of stood out from everything else in the room. She was a trim woman in a red faux leather top and short skirt that showed a lot of cream-colored skin, none of it unwelcome to the eye. She was the kind of woman that you'd notice in any situation. No stranger to trouble, but unaccustomed to being on the receiving end. And her thick, long hair was a luscious shade of red. Easy to spot, impossible to ignore. She was on the ground, her leg pinned by a large banquet table that had been overturned in the melee. Her eyes were wide with fear, and she reached her finely boned hand toward me in a sensuous come-hither gesture that seemed to say, "Save me. I'm about to be trampled by droids."
"And you were so close to getting out of here intact."
"She's trapped."
"By a table that can easily be removed by the policemen or EMTs that I've already summoned."
"But the droids..."
"Have shown no interest in harming anyone in the building other than you."
"But when I leave..."
"They'll probably follow en masse in their continued efforts to kill you. You have that effect on machines and people and animals and mutants and..."
I turned away from the exit and started running toward the woman.
"Then we have nothing to lose!"
"Except your life? Why in Gate's name are you doing this?"
"Because she's a woman!"
The droid stampede turned toward me as I ran toward the redhead. The droids were gaining much faster now. This was going to be uncomfortably close.
"Bring the hover up to the kitchen delivery door!"
I raised my gun at the onrushing horde.
"There is a delivery door in the kitchen, isn't there?"
"You're asking that now."
"Harv!"
"Yes, there is. I'll bring the hover and guide you through the kitchen."
I fired a couple of big bang blasts at the droid horde as they approached, obliterating a handful of the frontrunners. The ones behind them filled the space and continued the charge as we all neared the damsel in distress. I pulled my gun forward and aimed it at her. She saw the gun, and a look of horror crossed her pretty face. She put her red head to the floor and covered herself with her arms.
Mini boom!
A small blast sailed over her head and hit the table that had pinned her to the floor, splitting it neatly down the middle. She looked up and saw that she was free just as I arrived.
Oh, thank Gates.
Hold on to me.
Gladly.
I could see right away that she was unable to walk, so I helped her up, then threw her over my shoulder, my hand riding uncomfortably high on her shapely thigh, and I continued running toward the kitchen door, the pursuing horde just a few meters behind us now.
Harv?
I'm on my way, Zach. Use your left eye to guide you through the kitchen.
I blasted open the door to the kitchen and stumbled through the doorway. As soon as my feet hit the kitchen tiles, I closed my right eye and let the left take over. My view of the kitchen turned to black and white, and a bright red arrow appeared on the floor, leading past a row of sushi stations. Harv had flipped a switch inside my head and was using the lens of my eye as a GPS screen to guide me through the kitchen to the delivery entrance. I heard the Kabuki horde crash through the doorway behind us. The size of the entrance was upsetting their rush. They could only squeeze through in sets of two or three. They were slowing them down, but not as much as the weight of the redhead on my shoulder was slowing me.
Keep your head down. We're almost there.
They didn't mention any of this in the menu.
They never do.
I followed the red arrow around a corner and saw the delivery entrance doorway less than 10 meters straight ahead. Harv had taken the liberty of outlining it in red with a flashing arrow icon saying, "This way to the egress."
Harv, where are you?
Not near enough.
I blasted open the delivery door and kept running.
Do you by chance drive an invisible hovercraft?
Nope.
Because I don't see anything waiting for us at the hoverport.
My friend is bringing it up.
We were close to the door now, but the oncoming Kabuki horde was closer, and neither of us showed any signs of slowing. The floor shook from the force of their rush, and I could feel the heat of their laser blades on the back of my neck.
Will he get here in time?
No, we're meeting him halfway.
You've gotta be kidding.
I spun her off my shoulder and into my arms as I ran. The swipe of a sword caught the back of her skirt as she moved, slitting it up the middle. She slid her body across my chest and her arms and legs around me as smoothly as if we'd been dirty dancing partners for years. Then I ran through the doorway and leapt off the edge of the hoverport into the dank night air of Oakland, 1,000 feet above the ground. I'll go on record here, but I hate heights. Unfortunately, and through no fault of my own, my job has put me in many circumstances over the last few years in which I have found myself falling from high places. I don't mind it so much in the grand scheme of things because it allows me to recount those exploits by saying things like, "The sultry night air of Oakland stung my face like the wet morning breath of a lover from a seedy bar the night before, rank and unwelcome, with a heavy undertone of shame." The downtown neighborhood was no doubt nearly silent at the late hour, but I couldn't be certain because my ears were overwhelmed by the terrified scream of the redhead as she clung to me. She held nothing back as we fell, letting loose with a top-of-the-lungs wail of anguish born from the sheer terror of freefall. Oddly enough, the sound of her scream made her even more familiar to me. I knew this woman from somewhere. I was sure of it. But at the Nano, my memory wasn't working at full capacity. Her arms were wrapped tightly around my neck, and her bare thighs squeezed my waist so firmly that my body armor kicked in to ease the constriction. And part of me cursed the armor for being so responsive. I twisted as we fell, spinning us so that she was on top. The move frightened her more, since she could now clearly see the fast-approaching ground. But the twist was necessary, because despite the free fall, I knew that we were still in more danger from above. A glance up at the restaurant hoverport confirmed my fear. The Kabuki droids leapt off the edge in pursuit of us. I held tight to my gun and let loose a barrage of blasts as I fell, blowing the lead droids to bits and lighting up the Oakland sky with an impromptu display of badass fireworks. And just when the speed of our fall neared terminal velocity, I heard the familiar sound of hover thrusters and felt the smoothness of Corinthian faux leather slide across my backside as our descent slowed substantially.
Need a ride?
Cut her a little close there, didn't you?
Your internal organs are still safely inside your body. You have no reason whatsoever to complain.
Better hightail it out of here. The droids are still pursuing.
Oh, you needn't worry. I'm quite sure that the danger is past.
Harv made a big deal of steering the craft with his holographic hands, even though he was guiding it remotely. I gently put my hand on the back of the redhead's neck as she lay on top of me. She was stunned and confused from the landing. Thankfully, my being on the bottom allowed me and my armor to take the brunt of the impact, but it still had knocked her for a loop.
It's all right.
I gently rolled her off me.
We're safe now. It's over.
She opened her eyes and looked around, still shaking from the fear and the rush of adrenaline. She gazed at me, then at Harv, piloting the hover, then back up at the restaurant hoverport above us. Her face turned a pale shade of green, and she vomited on the hover's floor.
Ugh, sushi. That's going to stain.
Oddly enough, the sound of her retching jogged my memory in just the right way.
Aren't you Sexy Sprockets?
Sexy Sprockets is currently the most successful pop singer in the world, and has been for the past 5 years, which on the pop music calendar is akin to a geologic era. She shimmied her way onto the scene when she was just 14, warbling her multi-nuanced ditties, rasping her wise beyond her years riffs, and baby doll whispering her statutory rape-sweet nothings to a music download market that was up to its bare midriffs with naughty but nice starlets. I believe the descriptive term at the time was horgens, but that genre is so old school now they play it on DVDs. So, needless to say, nobody paid any attention to Sexy at first. There was nothing original about her sound or her fury, her style or her presentation. What's worse is that she didn't have a corporate sponsor to prime the star-making pump with the necessary credits, which was the kiss of death in the music world at the time. Then she changed management companies, leaving the mom-and-pop shop that had repped her until then, her parents, and signing with the mysterious S-Squared Incorporated, of which still not much is known, other than they represent Sexy Sprockets. Under the Svengali-like ministrations of S-Squared, Sexy's style was honed, her appeal was focused, and she found her voice. More importantly, S-Squared introduced her to a little thing called analog bandwidth, specifically 500 to 1600 kilohertz. Radio. AM radio, to be exact. And that made her career. Keep in mind that in the middle of the 21st century, AM radio was about as prehistoric as you could get. You might as well be sending smoke signals and drawing pictures of bison on cave walls. The music industry had been all about downloads for close to 3 generations, and the music audience was made up entirely of imps and pods. But for years, all music downloads had been controlled in total by big business. The conglomerates owned all the download sites. They owned hyping venues, and they owned the patents on the technology for receiving and playing music. They owned the award shows, the music critics, and even those annoying little music aficionados who used to hang around music stores making fun of the stuff you were buying. They're computer geeks now, who hang around the download sites and make fun of you in a virtual manner. Before Sexy Sprockets came along, if you weren't with the Conglomerates, then you weren't on the charts. Sexy and her team somehow found a chink in the Conglom armor, and that chink turned out to be AM radio. Simply put, society's use of wireless tech had been growing for 60 years like a fungus inside a broken refrigerator. There was RTF and satellite and a host of industrial uses, and on the consumer side, there was HV and cellular and Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi, Wat-Fi, Wen-Fi, Hu-Fi, and everyone's favorite, because I said so-fi. The world's growing use of wireless tech was using more and more of the available bandwidth, so inevitably the bandwidth used by the high tech started to bleed into the bandwidth of the outmoded tech, like AM radio, which had died a slow death and reincarnated years before with the advent of satellite radio. So most of the bandwidth that was once used by AM lay fallow, and inevitably began being used by some of the Wi-Fi technologies. And one of those technologies was the download and playback pods of the music industry. Sexy and her team bought up licenses for a chunk of the AM spectrum and began broadcasting her music onto the public airwaves. As planned, the broadcasts bled onto the frequencies of a lot of the consumer tech, and Sexy became a gatecrasher on millions of wireless consumer electronic gadgets. At first, it was a nuisance. There were a lot of complaints to the FCC and to the Congloms. The FCC at the time was entirely owned and operated by the Crusade for Family Values lobby group, and thankfully the government stripped the FCC of all power years ago. The Congloms set up various protections to minimize the broadcast's bleed into their signals, but by then it was too late, because a large chunk of the music audience, teenagers mostly, had listened to Sexy's music and had liked it. Their interest led them to the download sites, which of course didn't offer Sexy's music, which of course led to greater demand for the music, and by the time the Congloms caught on and tried to negotiate a deal with Sexy's people, she'd become a kind of cult icon for independent music, and was now more popular than the Congloms themselves. It's widely believed that she saved the Congloms from ruin when she finally struck a download deal with them, and there are rumors in certain circles that Sexy's company now owns a controlling share in the Congloms, in effect, running the entire music industry. It's a known fact that the company owns the entire AM spectrum, upon which her music is still broadcast nonstop. All that said, I personally don't like her music, but you gotta admire the guts of someone who can mess so thoroughly with a system. Okay. So where was I? Oh, yeah. Hey, aren't you Sexy Sprockets?
Yes. But don't tell anyone I threw up in your hovercraft.
It went through a death-defying ordeal. People won't think less of you. I handed her a handkerchief. She took it gratefully and wiped her mouth.
That's not what I mean. If my fans find out that I spewed in your hover, they'll likely to steal it. Right now, you could probably get 500,000 credits for it on Pit eBay.
I'll keep that in mind. I held out my hand and helped her into the back seat. I'm Zachary Nixon Johnson.
I know. I've followed your adventures.
You're a fan?
Not of you. Just the women you fight.
Excuse me?
You know, like Fora Thompson and Nova Powers, I heard she really spanked your carcass. And rumor has it you had a dust-up with BB Star. Gates, dude, you've been bee-slapped by all the greats.
Oh, the stories I could tell you, my dear.
Yeah, too bad we can't stay. Harv, those droids had anti-grav capabilities and they were following us. We have to get out of here.
As I said, Zach, I'm quite certain the danger is past.
Harv seemed to ignore the puzzled look on my face, although I'm pretty certain he savored it silently as he brought the hover gently to ground in the restaurant's parking lot, which by then was almost entirely empty. We all climbed out, happy to be setting foot on firm ground again, and looked skyward. The remaining 24 Kabuki droids filled the sky like a swarm of Bushido butterflies as they descended toward us. I pushed Sexy behind me and popped my gun back into hand as the droids touched down and raised their glowing samurai blades in unison.
I told you they were still after us.
And I told you, Zach, the danger is past.
They plunged their swords into their midsections and sent a cascade of red and blue sparks into the air as their circuitry fried from the inside. The smell of burning silk and plastic wafted over us.
Audio down, fade to black, and we're out.
A hover platform floated down from overhead and landed between us and the smoldering Kabuki droids. Three men stepped off as it touched down. Two of them were thin, angular, and wore dark tailored suits. The other was a paunchy guy wearing a pair of khaki Bermuda shorts and a shirt that looked like a lava lamp had exploded onto it. Harv gave me a silent cue that all three were unarmed, but I kept my gun in hand nonetheless, because I knew from the fine cut of the two suits, the dark tone of their evening wear sunglasses, and the amount of styling mousse in their hair, that the two suits in front represented an entirely different form of trouble.
They're entertainment attorneys, aren't they?
They're from Anus and Quagmire. I recognize their hair gel. They represent the Faux Network.
I'm suddenly nostalgic for the Kabuki droids. The guy behind them. Is that who I think it is?
Yes, if you think it's Rupert Roundtree.
Zacky, baby! That was stellar! Absolutely! A positively interstellar major.
Rupert Roundtree is the head of the entertainment conglom, currently known as Faux. It's one of the big three entertainment conglomerates in the current market, along with Intercorp and Microfun. It varies from nano to nano as to which conglom is actually the largest. It all depends on what companies they're currently buying. Entercorp is officially owned by Ona Thompson, with whom I've had some near-Armageddon-type dealings, but she's relatively hands-off and leaves the day-to-day business to the faceless board of directors. Microfun is owned by H-Tech, who utilize a probability theory management style where a group of 100 monkeys use yes-no pads, an abacus, and the spinner from an old game of Twister to make all programming, production, and scheduling decisions. Microfun's growth in market share over the past few years, by the way, has led Entertainment This Nano to include the Roomful of Monkeys on their annual Most Powerful list. And then there's Rupert Roundtree, whose hands-on approach to running his conglom is well known in the industry and with the general public, and whose lowest common denominator philosophy of salacious and gratuitous programming has been known to make even the monkeys cringe. Roundtree threw his arms around me in a weak-armed, fleshy bear hug, his paunch pressed up against my midsection like a vat full of jelly, and his aura of sweat and cologne was so strong that I suspected he was scent-marking me as part of his territory.
High-con effects, classic pitter-patter repartee! Short and sweet exposition, bada-bing, bada-boom! It's like it writes itself! Spectacular showcase-alocity!
What language is he speaking?
Hollywood. It has no real rules of syntax.
Roundtree released me from the hug and turned towards Sexy, who was standing beside me.
And Sexy, you were dripping with fabuliciousness, as always.
Roundtree turned back to the suits, who were still at the platform.
Didn't I tell you this would be stratospherical? Didn't I say that?
Yes, Rupert.
And why are you still over there?
Sorry, sir.
Okay, I'm gonna need a few things explained to me, preferably in English. And let's remember that I'm the only one here with a gun.
You're a jewel, Zaxter! Gates! Oh, I wish we were still recording! This would make great behind-the-scenes stuff for the 48K! Can we restart the recorder droids?
You do, and I'll restart my gun.
Oh, you're right! We don't want to break the fourth wall too soon! It'll ruin the stupendation of unbelief.
Well, this is starting to hurt.
Here's the coverage, Zakinator. The droids were ours. State-of-the-art tech, too, from AMP Labs. As you can tell, we're going big budget all the way on this project.
Project?
Righteous Omnibus, baby! Take a look in the mirror, my man, and you will see the face of the next great star of reality entertainment!
What?
A new series, Zakmeister! One man fighting against all odds every day of his life just to survive. One man in a world bent on destruction. A man whose life is no longer his own, forced to become a hero. One man running for his life.
Why does that not appeal to me?
We call it... Let's kill Zach! Pithiosity is key this year. Every week we send a group of killers after you. Machines mostly, droids and bots. But we'll need to use human assassins on occasion to keep the show's connection to humanosity. Yeah, we'll just have to get around the snuff film laws. Long story short, we record your heroics and then net them to the masses.
You want to try to kill me on a weekly basis for entertainment?
Oh, it's not about entertainment, Zakaroo! It's about the business of entertainment. Danger is entertaining. You, on the other hand, welcome danger.
No, I don't.
You thrive on danger!
I hate danger.
Danger is your middle name!
My middle name is Nixon.
Nixon. That won't work. Our legal people will get it changed for you.
Noted.
What?
Listen, Zakapalooza, people are always trying to kill you anyway. Everyone knows that. Why not turn that mortally dangerous lemon into some revenue-generating lemonade?
It does make sense on a certain level.
This is weird, even by HV standards.
And that's what makes it so brilliant! And with Sexy as the guest star for the pilot, this becomes Mega Max event-like!
No way, Rupert.
Sexy, you looked fabulous.
You show one pixel of my image on your pond scum network, I'll put Dark Shark litigation so far up your assets, you'll have my initials imprinted on your private resources.
Your turn of phrase is as tight as your sensuosity, Sexy. We'll hyperveil your face.
Not one pixel, Rupert.
Oh, fine. We'll replace you with a CGI replica for Netcast.
Voice, too.
Of course!
The CGI replica can't have red hair.
You got it.
And its ass better not be as nice as mine.
Ugh, like that's possible.
Have your shark call my shark.
Done.
Excuse me.
Don't worry, you're still the star, Zach baby. Can I call you Zach baby?
Can if you can say it with my fist in your mouth.
Gates! Oh, I wish we were still recording. Remember to use that quip next episode.
There isn't gonna be another episode.
Zach attack! We've already booked the series for the fall season.
You what?
That's why the shooting schedule's so tight. That's a good one. This shooting schedule's a real killer. Get it?
Roundtree, if you show one pixel of my image on your network, I will sue your pants off so quickly, I'll be running them up a flagpole before your cellulite hits the floor.
You're gonna be a star, Zakalaka. A fully-fledged pop cult, astronomical reality entertainment star.
He kissed me on the cheek. And with both.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.